Hello again, welcome to the program. It's good to have you with us. First, many of the biggest names in the Australian music industry would still be unknowns if they started out today. These days, if you don't have a hit first up, your career's over before it begins. This pressure's created an industry prepared to turn a blind eye to tactics that wouldn't be tolerated in any other business. Glenn Connolly explains. When you can't find
your way through the night. Casey Donovan holds a unique place in Australia's recording industry. Her song, Listen With Your Heart, went triple platinum before a single CD was sold. And believe it or not, this tiny little stall, which doubles as a church, is one of the most profitable music stores in the country. And how can this CD, panned and banned by many radio stations, become a top 10 hit?
The charts can definitely be manipulated.
Welcome to the murky and incestuous world of Australian music, where DJs own record labels, television stars manage artists, and where threats, favours and questionable deals are rife. But let's not get ahead of ourselves. Our investigation started with a couple of simple inquiries to see if what happens in the United States does or can happen here. In America, it's called payola. As songs are handed over to radio stations for that all-important airplay, cash, airplane tickets and holidays are handed over too. And it's not just wannabes. Far from it, it's the biggest names in the business. A federal investigation has found that Epic Records flew radio programmers on a sweetheart trip to New York in return for getting the Jennifer Lopez song I'm Real to air. There were similar contra deals for songs by Celine Dion, Good Charlotte and John Mayer.
It's called payola when it's cash. It used to be that they'd slip the $20 bill in the single as they handed it to the DJ. Then it evolved into drugola when they'd put the gram of cocaine in the single to the DJ. And now, of course, we have layola as well, where, you know, it might be offering prostitutes.
Phil Tripp is something of a legend in the music business, having owned his own label, worked as a high-profile tour manager, and most recently an industry analyst. He's running an industry conference in Sydney in a fortnight, which will look at these very issues.
It's not illegal to accept money to play music, and it's certainly not illegal to be the boyfriend or girlfriend or husband. But in America, interestingly enough, you cannot be the manager and the record company at the same time. And if you cross the line in being a broadcaster, you'd be getting a worse deal than Steve Vizard.
Radio play means chart action, and chart action means money. Number one means big money. So, of course, these record companies are going to go out and campaign aggressively to get their tracks on the radio.
Nui Tokoha is one of Australia's most respected music writers. He says if we think payola doesn't happen here, we're burying our heads in the sand.
Well, the sort of inducements and enticements that we're talking about, especially in the good old 90s, there would be handovers of white goods. A major record label was known to take radio programmers and tastemakers out for shopping sprees on an American Express card. All those sorts of things. Trips abroad. So no cash per se, but certainly some goodies.
Former scandalous songstress Tamara Jabo recently released this song, Ooh Ah, on the King Kyle record label. It's been branded a stinker, and some radio networks won't touch it, yet it's played repeatedly on the Oz Stereo network. Two newspapers ran polls to see what music buyers thought. 85 and 86% respectively slammed it.
This radio station is not in the business of doing favours for its employees, girlfriends or wives.
So how did it get to air? It's a question we put to high-profile Oz Stereo DJ Kyle Sandilands.
I think it's a good young person's song. It's not everyone's cup of tea. But as far as a hit song goes, it's good. It's hooky, it's dancey and it's fun.
It's no surprise Kyle's a big fan. You see, not only does he own the label which released the single, he's also the boyfriend of Tamara Jaber, who sings it.
You were suggesting that perhaps by playing the song repeatedly on your show and by having her on your show to perform live and interview her,
you're plugging something that
you have a financial interest in.
Like I would any other Australian artist. That's it. It's
but with any other Australian artist, you don't make money out of it.
I've made 1 cent out of Tamara, mate. Not 1 cent.
Well, yeah, I guess you're hoping to in the future if you own the label.
Yeah, well, hopefully I'll make a profit.
Kyle's not alone in exercising a little nepotism. Molly Meldrum used to have bands he managed appear on his Countdown program in the 1970s and 80s, but only, he says, after they'd succeeded independently. Richard Wilkins is the showbiz presenter on Channel 9's Today Show. Recently, he plugged a song called Are You Ready by girl duo Shakaya. Invaluable exposure for any young artists.
How do you think your music has changed since Stop Calling Me and all those hits of a couple of years back?
It has changed a bit, I think.
Some probing questions, but the girls look pretty comfortable. Not surprising, Wilkins is their manager. While he publicly admits to his role with the girls, that doesn't change the fact that appearances like this provide valuable exposure for the band. Making the top 100, top 40 or top 10 is priceless for any song or album. It ensures airplay, establishes momentum and generates all-important profits. But just how do we measure what's in our charts? Australian Idol winner Casey Donovan's first song went triple platinum with supposed sales of 210,000 before it had even gone on sale. You see, the charts are measured not on sales, but on distribution figures. Of the 210,000 discs made, only around a third were sold. The rest have either been sent back, are sitting in the back of record stores, or on sale for 99 cents. Industry whistleblower Paul Cashmere says music buyers are being taken for a ride.
I don't think that the general public actually realise that it's about what's being sold into store, not about what they're buying out of the store.
The other thing to remember is the Australian industry is small. You don't need to flog many CDs to make it onto the ARIA charts. Here's how it works. For a lot less than $1,000, anyone can break into the charts. Last week in Australia, the number 100 single sold just 157 copies. At about $5 per CD, that means $785 isn't a lot of money to crack the top 100. And the more you spend, the higher up the charts you can go.
You do hear whispers that certain managers or companies are sending teams out to buy the records to get them into the charts.
Former Australian Idol judge Ian Dicko Dixon used to be the head honcho of BMG Music in Australia.
It's not good business. It's, you know, you're really kidding yourself that you're, and frankly, throwing good money after bad if you're going to be prepared to do that.
This is the Hillsong Church, a New South Wales-based Christian group, which recently released their own CD called God He Reigns. They flog it at stalls just inside the church. Now, according to ARIA, these stores constitute a legitimate and official music outlet, even though they only sell Christian music and not much else. No Barnsley or Kylie here. Now, a couple of weeks ago, the church had a big convention where hundreds of good Christians snapped up copies of the CD, which meant, thanks to ARIA's bizarre chart system, God He Reigns went to number 2 on the national charts.
I think that charts are for people who like to count music by numbers.